So the Wildlife Science Center in Stacy is a nonprofit organization focused on research, conservation, and education. Reporter Kristin Haubrich introduces us to our state's largest wolf pack.
Hi, honey. Good boy.
Peggy, this is just wild for me. We're standing in the middle of a wolf pack right now, and they're not interested. They're not trying to rip me to shreds. In fact, it's quite the opposite. And the wolves that are in with us, they have a troubling backstory. What happened to the pups?
They do. Their mother was actually shot illegally by a person in northern Minnesota, and she did not die right away. She made it back to her den, and the pups were there, and she died then. They were in pretty bad shape by the time he was turned in and the pups were confiscated and they came to us.
Wow. So you helped give them a fighting chance at life, and they're thriving now.
They're doing very, very well, and very fortunate that they did not spend any more time out there between mom and us.
Wow. And this is a prime example of what you do on a daily basis.
We take in animals that don't have another place to go, and they're non-releasable, and that's really, so they're permanent residents here, and we want them to be comfortable, so we do everything we possibly can to make it comfortable for them.
They're not coming up to us. We are not a threat to them. These
You're
little puppies.
Frightening.
I am frightening.
Yes, you are frightening. See, they would come up to us if you weren't in here. So it just shows you how fearful they are, how timid they are. And once he's going to approach her, but even so, he's just a little bit cautious because he's not sure when he approaches, his whole body language changes. So everything he's saying to her is, you're higher ranked than I am.
He's very submissive.
Yes,
in that.
Very submissive.
Now let's go back to the beginning. So 1976, the federal government has their eyes on this part of Minnesota to launch a research center dedicated to wolves. And how did you come to get involved in that and then turn it into what we see today?
Well, it went from 76 to 90 under federal funding. I started in 1985, and I had studied wolves all the way through college, etc., but the wolves taught me that I didn't know that much about them. So for 5 years, I worked for the federal government, got to do some amazing things, but then the funding dried up, and my last job was to euthanize the 40 wolves that were there. And I felt like, no, they've given back to us.
Oh, that's heartbreaking.
I need to give back to them. So started a nonprofit. And what I wanted to do was, we wanted to continue the science, but I wanted to bring people in. I wanted to bring kids in. And so after 3 years of building nicer enclosures, we opened our doors for education in 1894, and we've had thousands and thousands of kids and adults come through the gates since then.
Wow, and home to now the largest wolf population in Minnesota?
Right. Education is so crucial. When you're talking about wolves, their opinions lie all over the map. And a lot of them are not based on fact. And so we are here just to share the facts, and we learn more every day with the research that we do here. And another word for research is study. We study them, and we share what they teach us.
Good boy.
You can't be more afraid of me than I am of you. Just things you just never think you're going to do. Just be holding bones surrounded by a wolf pack. So, Meg, you are Peggy's daughter.
Yes.
And you've been dubbed the wolf whisperer, right? And I can see why. I mean, they love you. Dwight, as you call it.
Dwight,
just licking your cheeks.
Yes.
How old? I mean, were you almost raised by wolves?
Pretty much. And I act like it sometimes. No, it's really been amazing because, I mean, we had Animal Planet here when I was 4. And that was the first litter I was really involved in raising. And it's been like that ever since, you know. And even those animals, when I was 4 years old, I was the adult in their life when they were growing up. And being able to form those relationships from tiny puppies, you know, those animals knew me when I was old enough to safely go in with them when they were adults. They knew who I was.
Sure.
And it's really amazing being able to say I've done this my whole life is, and it not be, you know, dramatic, is really special. Hi, Dwighty! Right here.
What does that afford you when you can be this comfortable and likewise back and forth and the wolves are so comfortable around you? What can you do with them in terms of studying and research?
Absolutely. So Dwight's actually a perfect example. So we have partnered with Medtronic for many years, and we have cardiac devices in many of our animals, but Dwight included, and they're tiny, they're non-invasive, they go right under the skin, and in less than 60 seconds I can download a year's worth of heart data. And so we're able to answer all of these incredible uncomfortable questions because of my relationship with Dwight and how comfortable he is. We don't have to do things like stress them out to get the data. And we have this device in our bears, our mountain lions, and many different cohorts of our wolves.
Do you feel like if we didn't have a research center like yours, where would we be with the wolf population in Minnesota?
Well, I think the really important thing that we can offer is real life perspectives. What do wolves really do in the wild? They're not gods and they're not devils. They are incredibly curious animals, and I think it really gives people a chance to see, and they don't have to agree with me, but I want them to walk out of here knowing more than they did when they walked in here.
Very cool. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you to Kristin. And if you would like to visit the center's 200 plus animals, you can do so on Wednesdays and on Saturdays. And of course, as mentioned, they're also open to private and school tours. So if you'd like to learn more about that, head to our website, minnesotalive.com.
Well,